Our first scripture lesson this morning is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 43, verses 1 and 2, which is found on page 1126 in the pew. Isaiah 43, 1 through 2. But now thus says the Lord, He who created you, O Jacob, He who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to sing the prayer, Be Thou My Vision. The words are in the bulletin. It is hymn number 502.
Some kind of boring tasks, and one of them was told that they were the person in charge. Midway through, a plate of four warm chocolate chip cookies was brought in, and after each person had taken one, the person who more often than not would take that last fourth cookie was the person with all the power, the one who was told they were in charge. Studies show that people who perceive themselves as having a lot of power are more likely to act rudely, to have an affair, and even to shoplift than people who perceive themselves as having less power. It does seem that Lord Acton was right. Power corrupts. So in a culture, and at a time right now so obsessed with power, in American Christianity, Jesus can be a really confusing person. Because what we want, what we're after, is the power, right? And Jesus, well, he died. Remember that? Remember that? He was arrested and tortured and executed. I can't think of anything that's less powerful. And yet, we also celebrate his power over the grave, over sin and death forever. So what gives? What are we supposed to think about power? If we look at today's reading in terms of power, I think there's a lot to learn. Jesus takes these three disciples up on the mountain alone, and already there are echoes of Moses, right? Do you remember he went up on a mountain alone, and he talked directly to God? Now that's power, right? And when they get there, indeed, it is a powerful scene. Jesus is transfigured. The Greek word is metamorphosis. He sheds his cocoon of human flesh and bone and just for a moment gives the disciples, his friends, a glimpse of the extent of his glory and his power. The story of transfiguration is always the last story we read before the season of Lent begins. And so it forms a kind of bookend to the season, with Jesus powerful and sparkly on the mountain at the beginning, and with the knowledge that in 40 days we will find Jesus incapacitated and tortured on the mountain at the end. We might prefer to make Jesus great again, to remember only the powerful Jesus, only the shiny Jesus, only the resurrected Jesus, only the mystical Christ who sits with us now. That's not the only Jesus we've got. When the disciples see the powerful transformation of Jesus, incontrovertible proof that he was indeed God incarnate, they become giddy with the possibilities. Moses and Elijah are there too somehow, and the disciples, drunk on power, begin to think about how they could preserve this moment. Think about what it could mean to them if they could prove to all the naysayers that this was God. I don't know what they were really thinking, but Peter wants to make it last. Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I'll start making some houses. We can stay. Getting the sense that Peter doesn't quite get what's going on, God intervenes. And a powerful voice that seems to come from a cloud. Hey, pay attention. Listen to this guy. Some of us find ourselves more often than not on the other side of power. It could be our finances, right? We don't have enough money to feel like we're worthy or we're making it. Or maybe it's our health or our emotional lives where things just keep happening to us and we feel powerless to stop them or even to make sense of them. Some of us are members of groups of people who have a history of being oppressed by the powerful in this country, whether for the color of our skin, or the person we love, or the country we were born in, or the bathroom we choose. So for us, powerless, the place where we enter this story is here. After the voice of God appears in a cloud, fallen on the ground and overcome by fear. If you've not had an experience where you felt that way, that's a really important thing to know about yourself, especially as we go into this Lenten series on race and reconciliation. But I imagine that most of us have had some experience where we felt that way, powerless, fearful, where we found ourselves face down in the dirt. And this is exactly where the real power comes in. The kind that we as Christians should be about. It's the power that Jesus offers, not dazzling white and shining, but a gentle touch and a soft connection. command. Get up. Don't be afraid. This is the kind of real power that Professor Keltner talks about in his book. It's a power that's developed by empowering others. Jesus' power was never about dominating or discriminating, but in sharing meals and hearing stories and healing touch. And it is this kind of power and no other that can actually save us. As much as we want to be strong and financially secure and healthy and in control, that kind of power really isn't worth much in the long run. What we need is a power that is stronger than greed and selfishness, stronger even than fear. And that is the power of God in Jesus Christ that is available to each of us new every morning. So today we're going to ordain a new deacon and install a new deacon and elder. And some of the people we approached to do this work, this service to our church, literally fell on their face in fear. But we asked them to not be afraid. They are faithful. The positions of deacon and elder in our church are positions of leadership, of power, right? But they are positions of power by God's definition. It is their job to touch us gently. And that's exactly what the deacons are constantly doing, with physical touch, with cards, with visits, and prayers, and phone calls, and meals. And it is their job to tell us not to be afraid. Like when the session works to discern our financial future, or how to use our physical space so the most people have access, or to imagine what might be next for us. But it's not just the officers of this church who have these jobs. It's all of us. All of you are ministers of the gospel, fully empowered to give love, to touch gently, to say to others, get up and don't be afraid. God has given each of us talents and gifts and skills and delights that are different from anyone else. So the way that you do these things will look different from the way that the rest of us do, and we need all of those expressions. No matter how afraid we are, Jesus is right there with us. The gentle touch, with the encouragement to get up. Not be ruled by fear, but to let shine the light that each of us holds within, the beautiful variety of God's people. Let us listen for God's word to us this morning. Clinton Presbyterian Church, get up and do not be afraid. Amen.
Amen.